Cambridge to write my talk title on the post-it note. So it's not what it says there. What did he say? Ubuntu Phone, you got owned, or something like that. Thanks, Stuart. I wanted to talk a little bit about a security incident we had recently. I'm going to explain it from my point of view as I saw it, used it, and I will probably not reveal absolutely everything because I can't, because I don't necessarily know absolutely everything. So I'll leave some time at the end. You ask questions, but don't be surprised if the answer is I don't know. So you may or may not be aware there are a bunch of Ubuntu phones on the market. This was our first one, the BQ Aquarius E415. That was the first one that went for sale. And BQ contacted us and said they'd really like to make another phone. So we then worked with them to make the Aquarius E5 HD Ubuntu edition. We also worked with a Chinese company called Meizu to create an amazing MX Ubuntu edition. So there's a bunch of phones out there in the wild that people have paid money for and run Ubuntu software. One Wednesday, a few weeks ago, we had a bit of a security incident, and I want to talk a little bit about that incident. Now, bear in mind that there are a bunch of phones out there in the wild that people are using, and something happened for those people. First, I was made aware of this was a post on Google Plus. So Simon posted on Google Plus this interesting note. He says, a new app in the store. So we have a store where users can download and install apps. And he is quite a keen user, will look at new apps that arrive in the store and basically install all of them and test them out, because that's the kind of guy he is. And he discovered that the app does something interesting, and can't really see it too well, so I'll zoom into those screenshots. So the left-hand screenshot is what it looks like on the phone when you're browsing the store and you look at the details for the app. So there's the app. And the important thing to note here is that it changes the splash screen when you turn the phone on. So this app monkeyed around with system level things that it probably shouldn't. And he ran that app, observed this, and then posted on social media, this looks odd. And when we saw it, we kind of went like that, because apps should not be able to do this. And so having an app that was publicly available to our customers was a bit of a bad thing. There were some comments that followed from other enthusiastic and amused Ubuntu users. The suggestion that someone should probably take a look at this. Now, this conversation is happening at about 11 o'clock at night UK time, near midnight. Some other people started taking apart the software and having a look inside it to see what it did. Robert Stroll is another user of the Ubuntu phone. He's a developer. He actually has apps on his own in the store, and he was interested to see what the app did. So he started tearing it apart and seeing, doing things like making screens against it to see what it did. Made some speculation about what the app did, some speculation about how it did it, and then there's a little bit at the bottom, because you'll notice in the screenshot, at the bottom right-hand side, where it says powered by Logan Map, that should say powered by Ubuntu. And that was the bit that got replaced. Yeah, that's the alarming thing. And he said, oh, could Logan Lamb be this guy, some security researcher called Logan Lamb? Could be, we don't know. It could be him, or it could be someone who likes him, or someone who dislikes him, or someone who just randomly chose that name for the fun of doing it. And then the glorious Stuart Langridge said, ooh, this looks bad, and summoned a member of the Ubuntu security team on Google Plus using this incantation that is commonly used. I was in a pub at the time when I saw this conversation, and I thought, this is a bad thing, we should probably do something about this. And two of the members of the Canonical team jumped on it So let me just rewind a bit and tell you a little bit about why that shouldn't have happened. So we do take security seriously with the Ubuntu Phone, and applications are confined. They're in a kind of container. They can't touch other files on the system. So an app that you install on your Ubuntu Phone can't go and get your contacts, or it can't go and get your photos, or and then upload them somewhere on the web. It has to explicitly ask you for permission to go and get your contact details, and you give it to the app. Or it has to explicitly ask for access to your photos, and you as the user actively have to give it. So the app shouldn't be able to do that. It also shouldn't be able to reach files on the file system that it shouldn't have access to. So apps have their own little area where they can store files and cache data and all that kind of stuff, but they shouldn't be able to touch anywhere outside of that. Now there is an exception to that, and the exception is that an app can be what's called unconfined. Now, users and developers are not actually allowed to make unconfined apps. You cannot upload an unconfined app to the store, it will get rejected. So we have an automated tool within the store that checks your apps, and if you put an unconfined app in the store, it will just get bounced back, you won't actually get it. There are two or three exceptions to that, and those are apps that we have created at Canonical. And I'll give you a good example of an unconfined app, the File Manager. The File Manager is a good example of an app that should be able to reach all the files on the file system, because that's its job, right? It's not on the phone by default, it's going to get it from the store. But that's an example of where an unconfined app might be useful, but normal terms can't create unconfined apps, you're not allowed. So this is about 11 o'clock at night, midnight, we got this notification. I jumped on IRC, like you do, from my hotel room, and we had a little discussion about what we should do about this thing. And this is some of the things that we did immediately after we saw the app in the store. The first thing was, I took a copy of the app, just in case the developer removed it. I took a snapshot of the app and put it in a private place, and then removed the app from the store, unpublished the app, so no more users would be affected. We then started the security team looking at the app and seeing what it did and how it worked and what it was trying to do. And we also looked in the store to figure out exactly who was affected by this. How many people have downloaded this app? And one of the managers in the store queried the store and found out there are actually 15 people who downloaded the app. One of them was me, obviously, and one of them was one of our other Canonical engineers. So technically, it was 13 people in the field who were affected by this. The jokers in the pack would say, well, that's everyone who's got an Ubuntu Phone, I'm sure. Actually, it represents a very tiny proportion of the number of Ubuntu Phones out there. So we notified them, we drafted an email to them and said, look, we found this thing, we recommend you don't run it, we recommend you take some additional steps to protect yourself. And I actually had a reply from one of the people who installed the app and said, hey, I've done some digging and I found out some information. Here's some information about how the app was made and how the app works. So it was actually really refreshing that people in our community didn't get their pitchforks out, but instead actually helped contribute to diagnosing what the app did and go about fixing it. So that was good. We then took some additional steps to freeze the store so that no more apps could be uploaded. At that time, we're talking about 1 o'clock in the morning now, nobody could upload anything to the store because the person who uploaded that first app could just upload another one. But we froze the uploads in the store. And then the security team started analyzing the app. We had to fix the tools that we used to scan the app. So in the store, when you upload an app, the app is scanned by an automated script, and that was at fault, and that was fixed. I'll talk more about that in a minute. What we also had to do is scan every other app in the store. There's about 2,000 apps in the store, and we had to go and get every single app from the store and interrogate them all to make sure none of them were breaching in the same way that app was good, and luckily, thankfully rather, none of them did. And we also built a new image and sent out a fix to the phone so that this could not happen again. once we'd got over that long night, which like we worked through the night from like midnight through till the next day, there were some longer term things we needed to do. We had to create the image and deploy that to all the users, so everyone got a new system update pretty much straight away. We had to do some wider investigation of the tools. So what it turns out they did, and the fix that we had to do, was when we scan your application to determine whether it can go to store or not, you create a manifest file, it's a plain text file where you specify the things that you want your app to be able to do, like have access to the camera, or have access to location, or have access to the network. But one of the options in there, as I mentioned earlier, is unconfined. And we scan it. If we find that, we reject your app. This app did not have unconfined it. But what it did do was it had a hidden directory, and inside that hidden directory was another app, and that one was unconfined. And our tools didn't properly scan through recursively through the directory and find this second app. So it was actually a genuine app with a malicious app inside it. And obviously we now fix it so that can't happen again. But that was how they got on an unconfined app into the store, was an app with an app. We issued a security notice, so if you Google for USM 2771, you can actually see the changes that we made to improve that process. We put a public blog post out, and we were prepared for, you know, a lot of media reports saying, you know, Ubuntu Phone is so insecure, it's terrible, it can wreck your phone. And actually, there didn't seem to be too much of that. It seemed to be more of the media reports were, well done on fixing that so quickly, and not so much on, haha, you guys got hurt, despite the title of this book. QA team had to obviously check those images that we sent out to people's phones and they were sent out. This is a little bit of detail about what the app actually did. So I've already mentioned that it was an unconfined app, so it could do potentially anything. But what it actually did was it was a little QML app, you just had a button. And this is actually an interesting point, is the app was just called Test. And I think that's partly why there were only 13 people outside the canonical who downloaded and installed it, and even fewer of them that actually ran it. Maybe if it had been called Netflix, or WhatsApp, or something like that, perhaps many thousands of people might have downloaded it and thought, great, and hit the button and then had their phone open. I'm not sure. But it was actually quite beneficial to us that the app was named Test. It actually didn't look that good. It went and reached out to a remote host, which had, if you go to the site, it's still up now, it just has a plain index that says something like, I should put some cat pictures here or something. And then there's a hidden field on the page which has a list of UUIDs which match the partition labels on an Ubuntu phone. So it reached out, gets those, and then decides whether to screw with your phone. It brute forces the root, the password for sudo, and then replaces some files in the recovery area, the thing that does the replacement of your bootstrap. And it then triggers a reboot of your phone. And the reason why it triggers a reboot of your phone is because the tools that replace the slash will be running only on boot. So it was putting a payload in the recovery area, then reboot the phone in order to trigger that to then be installed, which replaced the boot flash. So actually, the phone reboots twice, and after the second reboot, that's when you see the splash screen change. And that's a little bit of detail about how it got through the store and what it did. So yeah, we had a bug in our tools, we fixed the bug, you can't do this anymore. But no doubt other people will try doing other interesting, wacky things with our phones, because you know, that's what security research is doing. I don't know why. the email account associated with the account was a mail editor account, so it was a publicly accessible, anonymized like email address. I have no idea who owns that. I don't think it's beneficial for us to go on a witch hunt to find the person who did this. I don't think it would help us in any way to, you know, try and threaten them with any kind of legal, you know, means, I would probably say thanks to them because they've highlighted a security flaw which we've now faced. I'm not asking to do it something differently in the future, but, you know, what do you do? But it was good fun, and it was an interesting exercise for us, you know, as our first attack on, the first known attack on Ubuntu Phone. That's it. Any questions at all about anything to do with this? I don't know if there's another microphone, so I'll go with this. So the question was, Google does a load of testing on apps before they go in the store. What we do is just interrogate the app in terms of whether it fulfills all the semantics of what an app should look like. So, you know, are these files in the right places, you know, at a very high level, and have you specified the right version numbers? We don't run the app. We don't do anything in terms of someone sitting there curating it, looking at it, and running it. We don't do that at all. The goal has always been for the Click Store that we fully automate the app upload process. It just goes straight in. There's no human involved. We can potentially do that. The click reviewer tools that run in the store are on launchpad.net/click reviewer tools. And if someone wanted to contribute to that, I would patch it well, I believe. well volunteered. But yes, that would be an interesting exercise to run in a data center on a, you know, nailed down device. But yeah, we could potentially do it. Yes. The question was, why don't you use Chiru? Well, we use AppArmor. I'm not familiar with the technical benefits of one over the other, but the security team have chosen AppArmor as the way we silo apps on the phone. It works in that, you know, if you build an app, it can't break out of that silo, it can't touch any other volume system. So yeah, it works. I don't know why we don't use Chiru. Yes, James.
So two questions.
I'm not entirely sure why that is. It's possible that the partition IDs will be different on different devices. So whether it's an EQ or an AZ device, and I believe the splash is formatted differently on those two devices. And I suspect it's trying to use the UID to figure out whether you have an AZ device or a BQ device and flash your device differently. Because they're slightly different formats of the boot patch. No, the UID, you know, the slash dev, slash disk, slash UID, that thing. Because the image that you get on Ubuntu is a read-only image, the partition, those UIDs are not globally unique anymore because you've got the same partition set up on every phone. So I think that's why they did it. I'm not entirely sure. I don't think we do. No, I don't think the question was, do we offer bug bounties? I don't think we do offer bug bounties. We offer hugs and optional kisses. Generally, no. Yes?
I'm guessing that you said that you're not giving just a few of these matches going. Take loads of the back panel there with the black hat connection bar.
Right.
Obviously, it brings water. And
that's a good question. So the question, could we not look in a database on a server somewhere that has a unique ID of who has what phone? No, because we don't track that kind of stuff. You could go online, get an image of Ubuntu, and put it on a phone. You could have bought it off eBay, so it wouldn't necessarily be you who was the original, like, person who registered the device. But you could buy one, put the software on the phone, and have no interaction with us whatsoever. Like, not sign up for any service at all. And that's fine. If you don't want to sign up for any service, that's fine. So, no, I don't think we track that kind of data. And I don't think we would want to do that. I don't know the guys who work on the store. I don't know if they did look for some Google logo. I would be kind of surprised if you signed up to the store with that name anyway, but you know. Who knows? Any more questions? Sure. Yes. So the question is, having a four-digit PIN, which is also the password you use for sudo, is that stupid? There is an ongoing discussion in security about that thing. That is an ongoing discussion. However, you don't have to use a PIN. You can use a passphrase if you want to, which could be longer than four digits and much more complicated, which his brute force wouldn't have worked on. I completely agree with you. And I'd like to say, it's currently under discussion about how we improve that. I'm personally not a fan of fingerprints because you can't check. Okay. I've never not had a PIN for my Ubuntu phone, so I don't know what that would do. Without it being publicly available to the whole wide world, is that what you're asking?
No, it'd be more of a separate instance of whatever runs the app store that you can submit malicious apps to.
Oh.
But only people that have explicitly consented to being in this data zone.
That's an interesting life choice to make, isn't it? I can see how that might be beneficial. I don't know any plans to do that.
What does the store do to check that other than the other computer?
That's all I'm aware of.
Thank you. You cannot get your tools yourself.
In fact, when you build an app, the quick reviewer tools are run automatically for you when you build an app. If you use the Ubuntu SDK, you get the same reviewer tools on your laptop as we have in the store. So before you put it in the store, the check runs here and will tell you if you're doing anything stupid within the bounds of the check. There may be other things that the store does that I don't know, because I don't know the code base of the store. You have to ask someone who does. Probably got time for it. Yes, sir. So in somewhere I think the question is, could you run apps in an emulated environment? So we do have the emulator. Yeah. Potentially we could do that. I don't know if there's any plans to do that. It would be interesting to do that. I'm not sure of the value in doing it as for every single app. And whether we would necessarily spot a malicious app. I don't know if we would necessarily spot this one, for example. We might, but then we would probably fix the tools earlier on that pipeline that would stop this happening. I can see some value in doing that. I can see it's interesting. In fact, sometimes I sacrifice a device, I have a Nexus 7, I sacrifice a plugin and I install every single app from the store, one after the other, and I run them one after the other and do interesting things with it. We could probably do that. Yeah. Yeah. There's about 2,000 apps in the store and it takes a little while, yes. Yeah, it's one of those fun weekend activities that I like to do now. Okay, I think we're wrapping up now. Thank you all very much.